Hi my dear students, today we'll be dealing with the second chapter. The second chapter comprises of three portions, the ANS, blood and endocrine. ANS is usually considered a difficult portion. No, we'll make it easy. Please keep the textbook with you, whichever textbook you are referring, Padmaja or Tripathi. Keep the textbook with you and please turn the pages along with the slides. So let's go into the presentation. So let us learn from the basics. We have two nervous systems, central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Central nervous system means brain and all the cranial nerves, and the remaining is the peripheral nervous system. Peripheral nervous system includes two divisions, the afferent and the efferent. Afferent means coming from the periphery towards the spinal cord. Efferent means coming out from the spinal cord towards the peripheries. So that is afferent and efferent. And this efferent division is again classified into autonomic nervous system and somatic system. And this autonomic system is what we are going to learn. The autonomic system can be again put into three groups: enteric, which means the gut system, then the sympathetic and the parasympathetic system. And we are all the more concerned about the sympathetic and the parasympathetic systems. The two functional divisions of the efferent neurons are somatic and autonomic. The somatic subdivision is more concerned with activities with the voluntary nature. So here one neuron will innervate the skeletal muscles and it will control the voluntary functions of the muscle. If you want to move your hand or your leg, your muscle should function. So one nerve innervating this muscle, and voluntarily we are doing something. Our movements, our respiration, our posture, all these are somatic system. Autonomic system means most of the activities are involuntary. It is without our voluntary control. So already mentioned, the autonomic nervous system has a parasympathetic system and a sympathetic system. The parasympathetic system dominates in sleep and rest of the person. Okay, so in our rest position or when we are sleeping, our parasympathetic system is more active. Our sympathetic system is dominated during activity. Example, flight, fight, fright responses will stimulate our sympathetic system. So whether it be sympathetic or parasympathetic, the system works like this. Look in the figure. There is a preganglionic neuron arising from the brain or the spinal cord. This neuron, with the help of a neurotransmitter, communicates with the postganglionic neuron, and the postganglionic neuron, with the help of a transmitter, again communicates with the effector organ. So this is the system from the brain or spinal cord. Preganglionic neuron with a neurotransmitter communicates with the postganglionic neuron. Then this innervates the effector organ. So you have to keep in mind the ganglion is an important part of this system. So let us make sympathetic and parasympathetic systems clear. First, the sympathetic system, we already mentioned, it is dominating when we are active and aroused. Okay, so when we sense danger, look at that figure, a person who senses danger, either he thinks of flight or he gets frightened or he fights. So whatever it is, its heart rate increases, right? We all would have experienced this. Heart rate increases, so our BP will also rise. Our eyes dilate. Look in the figure again, the bronchioles expand. Okay, haven't you felt taking long and deep breaths? Then the blood flow to our muscles increases, so therefore the tone of the muscles increases. Look at his hands, how tense it is. So this is how the sympathetic system works. Okay, parasympathetic system, just imagine when we are so calm and cool. Okay, it is dealing with the essential body functions like digestion, elimination of the waste products, constriction of your bladder, constriction of your rectal muscles. All these are activated by the parasympathetic system. It decreases the heart rate. You are calm and cool. Look at the figure again. That person has a decreased heart rate. He is relaxing. He is sitting on his toilet seat. So it is concerned with the constriction of the bladder and the rectal muscles and elimination of waste products. Then there is constricted bronchial muscles because he is not taking any deep breath. He is in his calm and cool mode. There is meiosis or constriction of the pupils. See, he is reading a newspaper, constricted pupils. And this mode saves energy. So the parasympathetic system is saving the energy for you. You are calm and cool. You are resting, or it is also active during your sleep. Sympathetic system, just imagine when you are frightened, what all happens. So we discussed what changes the sympathetic system and parasympathetic system brings in our body. Now let us see some of the differences. The parasympathetic system is known as the craniosacral division. You know, there is in our vertebral column, cranial, thoracic, lumbar, sacral and coccygeal. These divisions are there. So from the cranial and the sacral, from the topmost and the bottommost portion, the nerves arises, the spinal nerves arises, and these preganglionic fibers, that is the, from the cranial nerve nuclei of 3, 7, 9, 10 and from the sacral region, these are involved in the parasympathetic system. You can look at the figure. Okay, the left side is the parasympathetic system. So the topmost and the bottommost, the cranial and the sacral nerves, 3, 7, 9, 10 of the cranial nerves and from the sacral region. This is involved in the parasympathetic system. Whereas in the sympathetic system, you can see it is the thoraco-lumbar division. The thoracic and the lumbar portions of the nerves, spinal nerves are involved. In the parasympathetic system, you can see the synapse is close to the effector organ. The ganglion is near the organ. So the synapse is close to the organ. You can see that when it arises from the spinal cord, there are long nerves and there is a synapse near the organ. Then a short nerve is arising. So long preganglionic and short postganglionic fibers is the characteristic of parasympathetic system. It is the ulta in sympathetic system. You can see the ganglions are very close to the spinal cord. So from the spinal cord, it arises a short nerve, synapses in the ganglion. Then a long postganglionic nerve innervates the effector organ. So short preganglionic and long postganglionic fibers is the characteristic of sympathetic nervous system. So I think you are clear about the basics about sympathetic and parasympathetic system. Now going into the drugs affecting the ANS. There are two types. It is cholinergic drugs and adrenergic drugs. The cholinergic drugs act on the receptors activated by acetylcholine, and adrenergic ones act on the receptors activated by norepinephrine or epinephrine or adrenaline. That is why it is called adrenergic. The receptors of ANS are parasympathetic or cholinergic receptors. Then you have sympathetic or adrenergic receptors. So when you give cholinergic drugs, it activates the parasympathetic system. And when you give adrenergic drugs, it activates the sympathetic system. And for the parasympathetic or cholinergic system, there are five type of muscarinic receptors, M1 to M5, and you have nicotinic receptors. So muscarinic and nicotinic receptors. For the sympathetic system, you all know this. You have alpha and beta receptors, alpha 1 and 2, beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. So alpha and beta are there. In addition, you have dopamine receptors D1 to D5. So these are the receptors. Muscarinic and nicotinic are for parasympathetic system. Alpha, beta and D receptors or dopamine receptors are for sympathetic system. Let's learn the classification of cholinergic drugs. It is put into three classes: esters of choline, cholinomimetics, and anticholine esterases. Esters of choline are ending with the name col or choline. So it is acetylcholine, methacholine, carbachol, bethanacol. All these are esters of choline. Then you have compounds mimicking acetylcholine. These are cholinomimetic alkaloids, and the examples are pilocarpine and muscarin. Pilocarpine, muscarin. Then you have anticholine esterases. These are not choline esters or cholinomimetics. These are the compounds which destroys the choline esterase enzyme. What does choline esterase enzyme do? It metabolizes acetylcholine, or it finishes off the acetylcholine. So when you give something which inhibits the substance, it results in accumulation of acetylcholine and it brings about a cholinergic effect. Such anticholine esterases can be reversible and irreversible. The reversible ones are the stigmins and the onium drugs. Neostigmin, physostigmin, pyridostigmin, ambinonium, edrafonium. All these are anticholine esterases, or which binds with the choline esterase to inhibit it and result in accumulation of acetylcholine. But the effect is reversible. The irreversible ones are organophosphorus compounds. These will bind with the choline esterase enzyme and it is a irreversible binding. So this is how the anticholine esterases works. The blue colored one is the acetylcholine esterase enzyme. The acetylcholine esterase enzyme has two sites, anionic site and esteratic site. So the acetylcholine binds to both the anionic site and the esteratic site, and the binding is reversible in milliseconds. This is what happens normally. Then look at our edrafonium drug. Edrafonium drug belongs to reversible group, right? And as it binds only to the anionic site, its binding is reversible very fastly, reversible in minutes. The other reversible anticholine esterases binds to both the anionic and the estratic sites, and the binding is reversible in hours. It takes more time. About our irreversible compounds or the organophosphorus compounds, it binds only to the estratic site and it is irreversible, except ectothiophate. Okay, the ectothiophate, even though it is an organophosphorus compound, it binds to both the anionic and the estratic sites. So there are a lot of questions in this image. Be clear, there are two sites, anionic and estratic. Edrophonium binds only to the anionic site, it is reversible in minutes. All the others binds to both the sites and it is reversible in hours. All the organophosphorus compounds except ectothiophate binds only to the estratic site and it is irreversible. Ectothiophate binds to both the anionic and the estratic sites. So what are the effects of cholinergic drugs? In simple terms, you can remember it increases all the secretions, because we already mentioned it is concerned with the baseline functions, and it, when it is overstimulated, all the secretions increase. Also, you can remember it using the acronym sludge. So S, it increases the salivation, then L for lacrimation, then you have urinary incontinence, or you can't control the urine, it goes without your knowledge, then diarrhea, then because of this you can have GI cramps, and there is emesis. So all the secretions increase. If you see each effect, you can see secretions increasing, right? Coming to uses. So the first use is it is used as a meiotic, or to constrict the pupil of the eye. We have already mentioned the meiosis of the eye is a parasympathetic action. Next is myasthenia gravis. Myasthenia gravis is a condition with weakness of the muscles and rapid and easy fatigability of the muscles. Why is this happening? Because in the neuromuscular junction, there are nicotinic receptors. Our body will produce antibodies against these nicotinic receptors, autoantibodies, and this results in the decreased number of receptors at the neuromuscular junction. Therefore, what happens? The muscle is not getting any stimulus for its contraction, so there is weakness with rapid and easy fatigability. So in myasthenia gravis, we can use cholinergic drugs. So there are two terms which are important in this context, is myasthenic crisis and cholinergic crisis. Factors like infection, surgery and stress can sometimes result in severe muscle weakness. This is called a myasthenic crisis. But when we administer more of a cholinergic drug also, there occurs a flaccid paralysis of the muscles. This is called a cholinergic crisis. So when a patient presents with severe muscle weakness, how do we differentiate whether it is myasthenic crisis or cholinergic crisis? It is by giving edrophonium intravenously. When you administer edrophonium intravenously, if the patient improves with this, it was a myasthenic crisis, and if the patient worsens, then it should be considered as a cholinergic crisis. Next use is in anticholinergic poisoning. It is obvious, when there is poisoning with an anticholinergic drug, you have to administer a cholinergic. Usually, physostigmine is given. Next is in postoperative paralytic ileus and urinary retention. We know the normal function of a cholinergic or a parasympathetic is increase in the bowel movements, increase in the digestion. There is constriction of the bladder muscle, rectal muscle, right? So when there is a paralytic ileus postoperatively, or when there is urinary retention, you should give neostigmine. Next is in cobra bite. Cobra venom is a neurotoxin and it can cause skeletal muscle paralysis. So to improve the neuromuscular junction transmission, you should give a cholinergic. Usually intravenous edrophonium is given to prevent the respiratory paralysis in cobra bite. Next is in Alzheimer's disease. There is deficient acetylcholine or cholinergic neurotransmission in Alzheimer's disease. So we have to give cholinergic drug. Usually rivastigmine and donepezil is given. So what is donepezil? Look at the classification again. It is an anticholine esterase and it is reversible. When we learned neostigmine, physostigmine, pyridostigmine, ambinonium, edrophonium, I told you these stigmine and onium drugs are reversible. Along with that, donepezil is also a reversible anticholine esterase. I missed out on donepezil when I taught you the classification, so don't forget. So donepezil is the drug of choice in Alzheimer's disease. I'll tell you one more addition in the classification of cholinergics. There was anticholinesterases, which included reversible and irreversible ones. Reversible ones, we brushed up just now, the stigmines, the oniums and donepezil is there. In the irreversible, organophosphorus compounds and carbamates are there. Organophosphorus compounds, you know, the pesticides, ectothiophate, malathion, sumethion, not the common thioterm in them. Also, toxic nerve gases like sarin and tabun are organophosphorus compounds. And carbamates, examples are carbaryl and propoxyr. Clear? Another important question is organophosphorus poisoning. You would have heard suicides by consuming rat poison, such things. So these are organophosphorus poisonings. The drug of choice is atropine. It is obvious. Again, organophosphorus compounds are cholinergic. So we should treat it with an anticholinergic. So atropine is given. IV administration 2 mg every 10 minutes till the pupil dilates. Because cholinergics are meiotics and atropine anticholinergic is a midriatic, or it dilates the pupil. So till the pupil dilates, you have to administer. Another option is cholinesterase reactivators, because in acetylcholine poisoning or in organophosphorus compounds poisoning, the cholinesterases are usually inactive. This also result in acetylcholine accumulation. So if you can reactivate the cholinesterase, which will metabolize most of the cholinergics fast. Okay. So auxin drugs are usually cholinesterase reactivators, like pralidoxim, obidoxim, diacetyl monoxim. These drugs you can give, but these are not useful in carbamate poisoning, because carbamates don't have binding site for the auxins. So auxins or cholinesterase activators can be given for organophosphorus poisoning. Coming to anticholinergic drugs. So we finished cholinergics now. Now we are going to learn about the anticholinergics. They can be natural or they can be synthetic or semi-synthetic. The natural ones are atropine. Atropine is the prototype of this group. Hyoscine, scopolamine, all these are natural. Synthetic or semi-synthetic ones are dicyclomine, hexacyclium, ipratropium, homatropin, glycopyrrolate. All these are synthetic or semi-synthetic. Some books put it into three classes: natural, semi-synthetic. So it is half synthetic and finally fully synthetic. So natural, semi-synthetic and synthetic. Natural, we know atropine, hyoscine or scopolamine. Semi-synthetic ones, I remember using HIT, homotropine, ipratropium bromide and tiotropium bromide. So HIT is used to remember semi-synthetic derivatives. Synthetic substitutes are put into three classes based on their predominant action. So one is midriatics, two is antispasmodic anti-secretory, and three is anti-Parkinsonian agents. Midriatics, I remember using this image, the techs, usually the techies, you know, they sit on in front of their computers like this. So the dilated eyes, I used to remember midriatics. So tech is the acronym: tropicamide, eucatropin and cyclopentolate. Antispasmodic anti-secretory agents, one is a common name, glycopyrrolate, and others are mostly INE drugs: propanthiolin, dicyclomine, telazepin, telterodin, propivarin, all these. And anti-Parkinsonian agents are benzhexol, benztropin, trihexyphenidyl. So benzhex, such names, benzhexol, benztropin, trihexyphenidyl are anti-Parkinsonian agents. Coming to the uses. First one, antispasmodic. It is used as an antispasmodic. We know bowel movements are stimulated by cholinergics. So anticholinergics can be used as antispasmodic. It is used in diarrhea, dysentery, in renal and biliary colic, in nocturnal enuresis of children. So all these contractions are inhibited by anticholinergics. Second one is midriatic and cycloplegic. Midriasis, you know, cholinergics are meiotic agents, anticholinergics are midriatic agents, or they dilate the pupil. It also has cycloplegic action. Cycloplegia means it is paralyzing the ciliary muscles. So it is used for optic testings. Then it is used as a pre-anesthetic medication. That is also easy to remember, because acetylcholine increases all the secretions. Its antagonist, atropine, or every anticholinergic decreases all the secretions. So it is used as a pre-anesthetic medication. It is used in organophosphorus poisoning. Organophosphorus compounds are cholinergic. So in that poisoning, we can use their antagonists. And finally, it is also used in motion sickness. That also you can remember, along with the, it is used as an antispasmodic in diarrhea, dysentery and all that. Right, so along with that, vomiting during traveling or travel sickness is also prevented. So secretions in any form, whether it be loose stools, it be vomitus, no, atropine is not going to let that.
So we dealt with the parasympathetic system. We learned the cholinergics and the anticholinergic drugs. Now we have to go to the sympathetic system. So we have to learn about adrenergics and anti-adrenergics. So I want you to make one thing very clear, that I used to think that the sympathetic system and the parasympathetic system, because one dominates in rest and sleep and the other dominates when you are active, don't think all their effects are opposite to each other. I used to do this mistake. I used to think if a cholinergic drug is doing something that is about the parasympathetic system, an adrenergic drug should do the opposite action. That is definitely not the case. If a cholinergic drug is doing something, the anticholinergic drug can oppose its action. If an adrenergic drug is doing something, an anti-adrenergic drug can oppose its action. Don't confuse sympathetic and parasympathetic drugs as having opposing actions to each other. Okay. So about the adrenergic system or the stimulants of the sympathetic system. There are two type of receptors, alpha receptors and beta receptors. The action of every adrenergic drug, this adrenergic drug can bind to either of these receptors. So its action is primarily dictated by which receptor it is having more affinity to, or which receptor it binds predominantly to. So alpha receptors are generally excitatory, except in GIT. So if a drug binds to alpha receptor, it is going to show excitatory effects, but inhibition on the GIT. Similarly, if a drug is binding on the beta receptor, it is going to show inhibitory effect in your body, but in the heart it is showing excitatory effect. In the figure you can see the noradrenaline, which is stored in the vesicle. It is released near the effector organ and it goes and binds to either alpha receptor or beta receptor and gives its response. There are two alpha receptors, alpha 1 and alpha 2, and three beta receptors, beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. So we are going to learn the alpha 1, alpha 2 and beta 1, beta 2 because these are the important ones. So it is very important for you to remember the effects, and it is easy also. The alpha 1, look at the effects, it increases the force of heart contraction. We already said it is excitatory. So increases heart contraction, vasoconstriction increases, increases BP, midriasis happens, that is also excitatory. Salivary gland secretions decreases. Yes, salivary gland is a part of GIT, so it is inhibitory there. Bladder and prostate capsule increases contraction and ejaculation, all the excitatory effects. Alpha 2, its major effect is inhibiting the release of norepinephrine. See, look in the figure, when the location of alpha 1 receptor is on the postsynaptic end or the effector organ, whereas alpha 2 receptors, look closely, its location is in the presynaptic end. So what when there is so much of norepinephrine, alpha 2 receptors are stimulated, and alpha 2 receptors tell that release less of norepinephrine. So that is happening in that figure. So alpha 2 inhibits the release of norepinephrine. Therefore, when all the blood vessels were constricted, a decrease in the secretion of norepinephrine will lead to dilatation of the blood vessel, and this will produce hypotension. Then since it is belonging to the alpha family, it will be inhibitory to the GIT, so it decreases the GI motility and tone. Coming to beta 1. Beta 1, we said it is inhibitory everywhere but not on heart. So it increases the heart rate and contraction, increases renin secretion and increases the BP. Beta 2, again inhibitory action, so dilatation of the bronchioles, the stimulation will lead to constriction, right? So dilatation, GI and uterine relaxation, increase in the blood sugar through glycogenolysis, increased blood flow to the muscles. So all these inhibitory effects can be seen. Coming to the adrenergic drugs or the sympathomimetic drugs, it is classified into three groups: directly acting, indirectly acting and mixed. Directly acting means it is directly acting on the receptors. So drugs like adrenaline, noradrenaline and isoprenaline are directly acting. So what is the difference between adrenaline and noradrenaline? Noradrenaline is the precursor of adrenaline. You can look into that pink color box. So this is formation. It is from the amino acid tyrosine. DOPA is formed, dopamine is formed, then noradrenaline is formed, and from that adrenaline is formed. Then indirectly acting ones, the directly acting ones directly binds to the receptors, alpha or beta receptors. Indirectly acting sympathomimetic drugs will increase the release of these directly acting agents. They do not bind to the receptors directly. So such drugs are amphetamine and tyramine. Indirectly they act as sympathomimetics, and the mixed ones, they can go and bind onto the receptor as well as they can increase the release. Such drug is ephedrine. Clear? So there are a lot of adrenergic or sympathomimetic drugs. For ease, we will put it into two groups, selective and non-selective. Selective means stimulating only a particular receptor. Non-selective means it can stimulate or bind to multiple receptors. So first we'll see the selective ones. The selective alpha ones are phenylephrine and methoxamine. So I remember it using PM or Prime Minister. It selectively binds only to the alpha 1 receptor. So the one or the prime thing is Prime Minister, phenylephrine or methoxamine. And alpha 2 receptors, these selective alpha 2 receptor drugs are clonidine and methyl-dopa. It is CM. After PM, it is CM, Chief Minister. So 1 was PM and 2 is CM, clonidine and methyl-dopa. Beta 1 receptor stimulant, there is only one drug, it is dobutamine. So dobutamine, you can easily remember it, it stands alone, okay, stands one. And beta 2 receptor stimulants are all the anti-asthmatic drugs or their respiratory system drugs, salbutamol, salmeterol, formoterol, terbutalin. So you can easily remember all these drugs acting on the respiratory system or the anti-asthmatic drugs are beta 2 receptor stimulants. So alpha 1 adrenergics are phenylephrine and methoxamine, alpha 2 are clonidine and methyl-dopa, beta 1 is dobutamine, and beta 2 are salbutamol, salmeterol, formoterol, terbutalin. Clear? Coming to non-selective, the drugs which stimulate alpha 1 and alpha 2 receptors are oxymetazoline, xylometazoline, nafazoline. These drugs are used as nasal decongestants. Other nasal decongestants are phenylephrine, mefenderamine, metaraminol. These are also nasal decongestants, but they are not non-selective stimulants which stimulate alpha 1 and alpha 2. Phenylephrine, you know, it is selective for alpha 1. Mefenderamine is usually an indirect drug and metaraminol has beta effects also. So next is beta 1 and 2, drugs acting on beta 1 and 2 receptors, isoprenaline. Epinephrine acts on alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, all the four receptors. And norepinephrine acts on alpha 1, alpha 2 and beta 1, never on beta 2. Not that point, norepinephrine cannot act on beta 2 receptors. Coming to the effects of the adrenergic drugs, you have to remember this, you have one heart and two lungs. So the predominant receptor on heart is beta 1 and on lung is beta 2. Remember in the classification also we learned all the beta 2 agonists were respiratory drugs, right? Salbutamol, formoterol, all those. So on the cardiovascular system, adrenaline acts as a powerful cardiac stimulant by acting through the beta 1 receptor. It increases the heart rate, force of contraction, cardiac output, conduction velocity, because we know beta receptors are excitatory on heart. Then smooth muscles, especially of bronchi, adrenaline acts as a powerful bronchodilator through beta 2 receptor and it is a weak respiratory stimulant. In the eyes, adrenaline acts as a mydriatic agent because it is acting through the alpha receptor. Then in the skeletal muscle, catecholamines facilitate neuromuscular transmission. In short, alpha 1 stimulation leads to vasopressor effect and it is used as nasal decongestant because it contracts the blood vessels of the nasal mucosa or brings about the vasoconstriction of the nasal mucosa. And beta 2 effects are bronchodilation, vasodilation and uterine relaxation, because except on heart, everywhere it has inhibitory effect and it causes all the dilatations and relaxations. So uses of adrenaline, it is used in anaphylactic shock, you all know it is used in cardiac arrest cases, direct intercostal injection into the heart is given. Then for the control of hemorrhage, we are very familiar because we use it with local anesthetics to improve the field of vision or to control the hemorrhage. Then acute bronchial asthma. We should not get confused, all excitatory effects we were talking, suddenly acute bronchial asthma, we can use adrenaline to dilate the bronchi. Why? Because adrenaline can act on beta 2 and beta 2 is the predominant receptor on lungs. It is also useful in glaucoma to reduce the intraocular pressure. Now an interesting drug, amphetamine, which is an indirect adrenergic agent. Amphetamine is a potent CNS stimulant. So it increases mental and physical activity, alertness, increased concentration, attention span, elation, euphoria, and increased capacity to work. It also increases initiative, self-confidence, postpones fatigue. We won't feel tired. We will get improved physical performance. So it is used as boosters, performance boosters in athletes. It depresses appetite. We won't even think of food. We will be fully concentrated into our work, physical as well as mental. During exams, we frequently used to say, I should buy some amphetamine and have because I'm not able to concentrate. Please don't do that. It causes many side effects like delirium, confusion and hallucinations. Just be aware about amphetamine. Ephedrine is an agent similar to amphetamine because ephedrine is a mixed agent. It is direct as well as indirect. So it acts by the stimulation of alpha and beta receptors, also through the release of noradrenaline. Repeated administration can result in tachyphylaxis. Tachyphylaxis means decreasing effect will be seen when you repeatedly administer this drug. Like adrenaline, ephedrine is also a smooth muscle relaxant, so it can be given in bronchial asthma, though it is not preferred now. Then just like amphetamine, this is also a CNS stimulant. This produces insomnia or sleeplessness, restlessness, anxiety, tremors and increase of the mental activity. Amphetamine and ephedrine are also considered useful in narcolepsy. Narcolepsy is when we can't control our sleep. It is an irresistible desire to sleep. So amphetamine and ephedrine can keep our CNS awake by acting as a stimulant. That's all about the adrenergics. Now, antiadrenergics or sympatholytics. So antiadrenergics are blockers of the adrenergics. They bind to the adrenergic receptor and they prevent the action of the adrenergic drugs. They may be alpha blockers, beta blockers, or a drug can block both the alpha and beta receptors. So first we will see alpha blockade. Alpha blockade, it can be alpha 1 blockade or alpha 2 blockade. In alpha 1 blockade, what happens? Alpha 1 receptors are having vasopressor effect. So this is inhibited, leading to vasodilatation and fall of BP. So alpha 1 blockade leads to fall of BP. Therefore, alpha 1 blockers are used as antihypertensive agents. Alpha 2 blockade, what happens? You know, there is enhanced release of noradrenaline. Usually alpha says don't release much of noradrenaline. So when alpha 2 is blocked, there is much release of noradrenaline. And what this noradrenaline will do? It will stimulate the beta receptors. Why? Alpha is already blocked, so it will stimulate the beta receptors. And this beta stimulation leads to tachycardia and increase in cardiac output. So that is how alpha 1 blockade and alpha 2 blockade works. Alpha 1 blockade leads to a fall of BP. Alpha 2 blockade will lead to increased heart rate, tachycardia and increased cardiac output. Coming to alpha blockers classification, it can be non-selective or it can be selective. Non-selective means it is not selective for alpha 1 or alpha 2. It can block both. This can be a non-competitive blocker or competitive blocker. Non-competitive blocker, you should remember phenoxybenzamine. Non-competitive is phenoxybenzamine. Competitive blockers are four agents we have to learn. So before that, competitive means this will compete with the adrenergic agent for the receptor site. So both of them are having similar structure. Non-competitive blocker, they don't have similar structure as that of the adrenergic drug. They bind elsewhere on the receptor to distort the receptor so that the adrenergic drug cannot bind. So competitive blocker means it looks similar to the adrenergic drug, right? So there are a pair of similar names in competitive blockers. Two amines, ergotamine and phentolamine, and one azine and azoline, chlorpromazine and tolazoline. So two amines, one azine and azoline, you have to remember in competitive blockers. Because competitive blockers have similar structure, two pairs of similar names you remember in competitive blockers. Ergotamine, phentolamine, chlorpromazine, tolazoline, right? Now selective means selective alpha 1 blockers will block only alpha 1 and alpha 2 will block only alpha 2. Alpha 1 blockers are, as we already mentioned, these are antihypertensive agents. These drugs names end with the name SIN. Prazosin, terazosin, doxazosin, tamsulosin, alfuzosin. So it is pretty easy. Alpha 2 blocker is yohimbine. So I think you are clear with the alpha blockers classification. Coming to the uses, phenoxybenzamine, which is a non-competitive blocker, can be used to the treatment of pheochromocytoma. What is pheochromocytoma? It is a tumor of the adrenal medulla. So it is a tumor which secretes more of catecholamines. Therefore, the adrenergic blocker phenoxybenzamine can be used to treat this. Next is tamsulosin. Tamsulosin has selective activity on alpha 1 receptors. It has activity in the bladder and prostate. General hypotension effect is mild for tamsulosin. So therefore, tamsulosin can be effectively used to treat benign prostatic hypertrophy. This is an important question. Benign prostatic hypertrophy is treated using tamsulosin, has been asked. Another agent is yohimbine. Yohimbine is a alpha 2 blocker. We know whenever alpha 2 is blocked, there is increase in noradrenaline. When there is increase in noradrenaline release, it can cause congestion of the genitals and it is used to treat psychogenic impotence. Coming to beta blockers classification, all beta blockers are LOL, laugh out loud, LOL drugs. So they are put into 5 groups: non-selective, cardioselective or beta 1 selective, partial agonist, then beta blockers with additional alpha blocking property, beta blocker and beta 2 agonist. First is non-selective. Non-selective ones are truly not properly selective. That is how I remember. So T of truly stands for timolol, N nadolol, properly P is propranolol, and selective S is sotalol. So non-selective ones are truly not properly selective. So timolol, nadolol, propranolol and sotalol. The cardioselective ones selected to our heart. So I remember ESMA, S is esmolol, and MA, M for metoprolol, A atenolol, A again for acebutolol. So this is cardioselective. Then you have partial agonist. Partial agonist have some terms in their names: OX, CART, PIN and PEN. That is how I remember. So oxprinolol, cartiololol, pindolol, bopindolol, pen-butolol. So OX, CART, PIN and PEN are there in the partial agonist's names. With additional alpha blocking property, again I remember it like this: we have carved a lot of teeth in our labs, right? So whenever we go with our carved teeth, they usually ask what is this additional cusp. So we have done a lot of carving in our lab with additional properties, huh? So beta blocker with additional alpha blocking property are carvedilol and labetalol. This is how I remember all these. If you people are having any better acronym or any better technique of remembering this, please use that. Okay, this is for people who find it difficult to memorize. And beta 1 blocker with a beta 2 agonist activity. It is a weird kind of combination. So that drug is celiprolol. Clear with that? Uses of beta blockers: it can be used to treat hypertension. It is useful in angina pectoris. We know beta blocker is inhibitory on heart. So used in the prophylaxis of exertional angina. It can be used to treat cardiac arrhythmias, and in myocardial infarction also beta blocker is found to be useful. It reduces the size of the infarct, it seems. Then pheochromocytoma, usually we give alpha blockers. Propranolol is given along with alpha blockers. Useful in thyrotoxicosis because propranolol controls palpitation, tremors and gives a symptomatic relief in thyrotoxicosis. Propranolol is used in the prophylaxis of migraine. So it reduces the frequency and severity of migraine. And finally, in anxiety situations, propranolol is used to prevent the panic symptoms. Example, stage fear kind of public speaking fear, examination fear and other anxiety provoking situations can be treated by giving propranolol. So that portion is done. Now we are pretty good about ANS, right?